Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the fourth meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2024. The first item on our agenda is for committee members to consider whether or not to agree to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you. Our second item and our main item this morning is consideration of the Auditor General's Section 22 report into the Scottish Prison Service, which was released in December. And can I welcome our witnesses this morning? We are joined by the Auditor General. You're very welcome. And alongside the Auditor General this morning is Michael Oliphant, who's an Audit Director at Audit Scotland, and Tommy Yule, who's a Senior Audit Manager at Audit Scotland. We've got quite a large number of questions to ask you about this morning's report, but before we get to those, Auditor General, can I invite you to make a short opening statement?
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, Committee. I am presenting this report this morning on the 2022-23 audit of the Scottish Prison Service under Section 22 of the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000. The external auditor issued an unqualified opinion on the financial statements of the Scottish Prison Service for 2022-23. My report, though, brings to Parliament's attention issues relating to the Scottish Courts Custody Prisoner Escorting Services contract managed by the SPS on behalf of Justice Partners. It also draws attention to wider concerns about projected increases in the prisoner population and its impact on the prison estate. Convener, I highlight the following areas from my report. The first is on the prisoner escorting contract. Scottish ministers awarded the contract to GOMA in March 2018 for an initial period of 8 years. In recent times, GOMA has been unable to achieve the staffing levels required to effectively deliver required levels of service. Between July and September 2023, only 62% of prisoners due in court arrived on time, and only 65% of non-court escort services, such as hospital transfers or police identification parades, took place on time. SPS has taken action to support improvement in GOMA's performance, including financial support to aid staff recruitment and retention. It is expected, though, that this will take a further 6 months to take effect. The second area of focus is on Scotland's prisoner population. In 2022-23, the average population was 7,426. By mid-November of last year, it had increased to 7,948, with the SPS now forecasting that the population will further increase to over 8,166 by the end of March of this year. This puts extensive pressure on the prison estate, which requires significant investment for it to be fit for purpose. Convener, these are not issues that can be resolved by the Scottish Prison Service alone. It will require close collaboration with the SPS, the Scottish Government and their justice partners to ensure that prison services can be maintained in a safe and secure environment. Convener, as ever, my colleagues and I will do our utmost to answer the committee's questions.
Thank you very much indeed, and that's a useful thumbnail sketch of the three principal themes in the report, which we will look at in some detail this morning. Can I begin by handing over straight away to the Deputy Convener, who's got some questions, especially about that Courts Custody Prisoner Escorting Service. Sharon.
Thank you. Good morning. The Prisoner Escort Contract is managed by the SPS on behalf of the Justice Multi-Agency Liaison Group, which consists of the SPS, Scottish Courts and Tribunal Services, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service and Police Scotland. Do you know what input those organisations had in the Justice Multi-Agency Liaison Group had to the terms of the GOMA contract before it was awarded by Scottish ministers?
So you're absolutely right, Deputy Convener, in terms of the partnership arrangements. And as I mentioned in my introductory remarks, the contract runs through to 2027 and is experiencing challenges. It is going to take a multi-agency approach to resolve the issues. I'll bring Michael in a moment, actually, just to set out a bit more about the background to the awarding of the contract. But this is effectively at the heart of today's report, that there needs to be an effective resolution to the scale of the challenges that are being faced by this contract. And as the report touches on later on, the prison service and their partners are already beginning to think about their arrangements for the next iteration of the contract. Of course, should there be one, I mean, that does remain one of the options at the disposal of the prison service. So reflecting on the lessons from the award of the contract last time will be very important to inform the stability of this service into the future. But I'll pause and invite Michael just to set a bit more detail for the committee.
Yeah, the agency partners that you highlighted have been involved from the start and are involved on a regular basis. The prison service manage the contract on their behalf, but the partners are involved in monthly performance meetings around the service, around the service reporting requirements of the contract. Some of the changes that we've seen since the contract was awarded, particularly during COVID and after COVID, the partners have been involved in discussing the really just all aspects of the criminal justice system, from police ID parades through to the prosecution services and so on, through to the numbers that are going in and through the court system in Scotland. One of the changes being the additional high court docs that were required to be serviced during this time. So it's very much seen as a partnership approach, all with their own direct interest in ensuring that the contract is served as best as it possibly can.
So did you say there they're having monthly meetings?
There's monthly performance meetings, yes.
And does that involve
It's quarterly meetings of the MAOG that includes Prison Service, Police Scotland and the Crown Office Prosecution Service, as well as the Courts and Tribunal Service. There's monthly meetings to manage the contract that involve people from Prison Service.
Right, OK. Well, kind of brings me on. The second question was the report highlighting the importance of SPS and its partners working together with support from the Scottish Government to consider all options available to ensure the safe and effective delivery of prisoner escorting services. Are they looking at the way they operate as well to see how they can assist GEOAMI? Because it seems to be a kind of change in service that they've had since the initial contract was brought in.
Absolutely. The number of changes that have to be made, particularly around the flow of staff through courts, so introducing virtual courts to try and assist, the number of high courts that come in to try and support the courts recovery programme. There's now fewer numbers being transferred from custody to courts because of a number of the interventions that the courts recovery programme has brought that involves, for example, sharing of evidence earlier before the need to get to a trial and to get to a court case to try and resolve these earlier. These all have impacts on the contract and the demands from it.
So they're all... Sorry.
Apologies, Deputy Convener. I think I was just going to add, hopefully relevant, is that there are clear interdependencies here in this effective management of the contract. As Michael mentioned, the conditions have changed since it was awarded, undoubtedly through COVID, the impact of that. And then as indeed the committee considered last year, the Scottish Courts and Tribunals plans in terms of addressing the court's backlog, that also has a bearing on this delivery of the contract in terms of contract volumes, the demands that are placed upon custody officers, what would have been fairly predictable and stable in terms of court transfers before COVID is no longer exactly the case. And this is, I think, central to GEOAMI's position that the environment in which the contract was awarded is no longer replicated to its entirety post-COVID. So there are different flows of prisoners. But there are other aspects that are relevant too. And you mentioned about working with other partners. One of the things we touch on in the report is about hospital appointments and so forth, and the clashing nature of when prisoner hospital appointments tend to be timed early in the morning, which is the time of when prisoner transfers to court would typically take place. So we've seen steps being made by the prison service to engage with the National Health Service to say, is there something that can be done that can work for both sides? But I think that, as we've seen, is still a work in progress. So There are opportunities still in here to make it more efficient, but I'm not sure it addresses the more fundamental nature of the contract environment is quite different to what it was when it was first awarded.
Yeah. And are they continuing that engagement? I did note, because the report, I think, said that the majority of the hospital appointments were 9:30 and that the SPS had engaged with the NHS, but we're still sitting with the majority of the appointments at 9:30, so that's not obviously helping GOAME. So there is constant engagement there.
Yeah, I think that's the circumstances. As far as our understanding is, that's an ongoing conversation not yet resolved to ensure the safe and effective delivery of this contract. We do recognise, of course, that there are multiple pressures within the NHS, and there won't be one single reason why that hasn't been accommodated, but it is an outstanding matter.
Thanks. It also says in the report the contractual arrangements for GOAME differ between Scotland and England and Wales. Are you aware of any issues or concerns with the service that GOAME provides in England and Wales? So is it the same problems they're having there, or is it a different contract, so it's different issues?
I'll bring Michael on again in a moment, actually, but I think it's just in terms of the scope of our work, we haven't looked at the fundamentals or the detail of the contract arrangements in England and Wales compared to Scotland. I think at a high level, it's our understanding that it's a broader contract in Scotland as it relates to an additional range of services that the prisoner escort service contract here provides compared to England, which, and Michael can clarify, I think it's primarily court transfers that in England.
It's effectively that. They're different contracts. The ones they have in England cover transfers from custody to courts predominantly, and police custody as well. In Scotland, you have additional elements to cover, which includes it covers healthcare facilities. It covers things like specialist quoted leave, so funeral escorts, escorts that maybe provide educational or employment opportunities as part of parole arrangements. So there's a whole host of additional services. Some of them are quite staff intensive. For GOAME compared to some of the route transfers, for example, hospital detainments and bed watches require a certain level of staff 24 hours a day to accommodate, and sometimes the demand is difficult to predict. The contract allows for up to 8 bed watches per day, but we've seen fluctuations to sometimes well over 20. So it's a very staff intensive part of the contract for GOAME. And that's one of the reasons why they cite it as being financially unsustainable.
Okay, thank you. The report states that the operating environment has changed since GOAME was awarded the contract in 2018. So is that one of the issues then? Is there other issues in there? But that sounds as if with the ageing population and the fact that the prison population is going up as well, is that adding to the problems?
Yeah, these are absolutely relevant factors about the wider pressures on the Scottish Prison Service. Drilling down into some of the nature of the contract, so undoubtedly the demands on the prison and court service post-COVID, tackling the backlog, the provision and how that interacts with virtual trials that Michael's mentioned is another factor. But perhaps most fundamental of all, Deputy Convener, is that GOAME hasn't been able to sustain staffing levels that were anticipated in order to effectively deliver the contract. I think it's fair to say that the prisoner custody officer roles are at the heart of this, and just how attractive these posts are relative to alternative jobs that exist. And I think at a high level, the general rates of pay that the prison custody officer roles attract are comparable with what somebody could earn in a supermarket, for example. So at that level, and bearing in mind the conditions, these are demanding, responsible jobs, not to say a supermarket isn't, but there comes with an additional level of stress and scrutiny in these roles that have, for a combination of factors, changing aspirations, employment patterns, have meant that they've not been able to sustain the level of numbers to safely deliver the contract. I'm sure we'll speak further about some of the steps that the prison service have taken to try and sustain the contract. But specifically looking at the staffing levels, is that there has been an additional investment from the prison service to try and arrest the decline in numbers, that kind of financial support that they are providing to GOAME, to try and sustain and then increase back to the level of staffing numbers that were required. Michael might want to say a bit more about some of the detail behind that.
So I think a key aspect of the contract is it's volume-based. So the more activity that's undertaken by GOAME, the more income they can generate from that. We've seen as a result of, or compared to pre-COVID levels, the number of routes from custody to courts has fallen quite dramatically as some of the interventions to support the court reform programme or recovery programme. The other parts of the contract that I mentioned are quite staff intensive, so hospital detainments, bed watches, supporting and servicing court docks and court cells. They are staff intensive. So overall we see but that volume increase doesn't offset the loss from the route transfers to courts. So overall we're seeing lower income as a result, higher costs as a result of staff costs, overheads, fuel and so on. But a key aspect of the contract is for the provider to have operational flexibility to accommodate that. But when you've seen staffing levels drop 20-25% from where they should be, you remove that flexibility to the point it's very difficult to manage that base service provision. So the real fundamental problem is that they don't have enough staff to service a contract that needs to be flexible.
So it's labour intensive, the money's going down in the tasks that they're doing. So unless they go in and actually change that contract, if somebody else took over that contract, are they just going to have the exact same issues?
I think there's been an element of speculation on our part to address that properly, but it's important context for the committee that when the contract was first tendered 2017-2018, GOAME were the only bidders for this contract. So other potential providers will have made their own business assessment of how sustainable this was and what it looks like into the future. As we touch on in the report, that the prison service is considering where to go next with their partners, and they'll need to get effectively that rounded view about what is a sustainable contract, whether it's one that's offered to the market or whether there's an alternative way of delivering the contract through public services. What's clear is this is in its current guise needing a different path, and the current path that the prison service are following at the moment is one of additional financial support to GOAME to keep it sustainable. I'm happy to say further, Deputy Convener, but there's been a variety of approaches that have been deployed in terms of financial penalties or financial support, but in the additional financial support largely in the current present. But looking into the future, these will all be factors that the prison service and the partners will need to consider for future contracts.
Touching on that, it actually says in one of your key messages, it said that several actions to support improvement in GOAME's performance included issuing improvement notices and applying financial penalties of around £4 million. And then goes on to say SPS is now taking more direct action, including financial support to support GOAME to aid staff recruitment and retention, which seems a bit of a contradiction. You're going to go and find them and then you're going to go and give them financial support. So to what extent may the application of service credits totalling over £4 million have contributed to GOAME's claim that the contract is financially unsustainable?
So I think we probably... So we're reporting the facts in the report. You know, so in terms of exhibits 1-3 are setting out the service performance of the contract. And some of that coincides with the application of service credits or fines, you know, and then as we've seen more recently, application of financial support. I think as we mentioned opening remarks and also in the report, the prison service expects it's going to take a further 6 months before they can form an assessment as to whether or not the financial support levels of 1.8 million in 22-23 and planned 2.2 million thereafter will have an impact on service performance. But the service credits application didn't fundamentally change the reduction in performance, and I think that's why the SPS has arrived at a point, well, if fines aren't working, is there a more of a financial incentive that might lead to a better application of the contract's performance?
Thank you. The report also states that in August 22, the SPS implemented a moratorium where it would not impose certain service credits. Can you tell the committee what areas they relate to?
Yeah, I'll bring Michael in actually just to share a bit more detail on that, Deputy Convener.
Yeah, the service credits, the detail within the contract itself, it divides the service credits into three categories. So the first one is about outcomes. So these are the most significant issues that might arise from poor performance. So if it led to missed appointments or delays to court proceedings, then a penalty per prisoner can apply. Even things like if a prisoner's at large or the prisoner dies within their care that's not connected to natural causes, there are certain service credits that have to apply. These service credits, such as injury by prisoners, death, prisoners at large and so on, are not covered by the moratorium. There's also aspects such as certain amounts of documentation that has to be provided, services that have to provide to the prisoner, including, you know, food and water and access to medical advice and so on. These are things that are not covered. Some of the things that are covered by the moratorium are looking at, late arrivals that don't impact on proceedings and so on. But that doesn't automatically generate a financial penalty. There's thresholds that apply, be it in a points-based system. So once they breach an overall threshold, then a penalty will apply. And it's based on a formula driven really by the percentage of the transfers that take place.
And did it say in the report it would take 6 months before we would see the impact of that then, whether it's been successful or not?
It would take 6 months to see the impact of the what's called the pass-through funding that the prison service have given to increase the pay rates of GOAMA staff. The reason it's described as pass-through is because it's designed deliberately to be passed directly to staff so that the pay rates can increase, I think, by 17% to take them above a competitive level compared to other equivalent employers and some of the big retail employers that they were potentially had, or they did have lower pay rates by comparison.
I think there was a press thing last week saying that the staff had to pay back money for their training. Do you know if that's still happening? Is that part of the contract with GOAMA?
I don't know if it's part of the contract. I think we see in quite a lot of organisations that have a training element to a contract that there can be these clauses that if someone leaves early within the contract, they might have to pay back a proportion of the training and so on. But I don't know the specifics around that in this case.
Well, a couple of times, wage comparator with supermarkets. But the genesis of this contract is that it was outsourced work that was previously carried out by prison officers and Scottish Prison Service staff. Wouldn't a better comparator be, given the nature of the work that's involved, a comparison with the pay rates that the Scottish Prison Service pays its own staff?
I think that's a very fair argument, Convener. And also, it's perhaps worth clarifying that the roles that prison custody officers do, if they are not available, the only alternative to the prison service is a prison officer or a police officer to carry out the function of transfers. So it's perhaps not for me to judge the relative rates that are fair to individual roles, but looking at the responsibility that is afforded to prison custody officers, I can understand why the Scottish Prison Services has arrived at the point where pass-through funding, as Michael describes, has been necessary to give more certainty and security for the safe delivery of this contract.
Okay, thank you. I think Willie Coffey wanted to come in on this. Willie.
Thanks, Convener. Just on the issue about potential financial support for GEO, they've just filed their accounts and it was signed off in September, just there. And it shows the company reported a profit of £2.6 million. It paid out dividends of over £4 million. And it's got cash reserves of £11 million. Why are we talking about financial support to a company with figures like that?
I think ultimately that will be a question for the Scottish Prison Service, Mr Coffey, to come to a view as to why it arrived at that decision. If I was speculating, there will be aspects of that organisation's business that won't apply to this effective delivery of this contract, and the Prison Service will have reached a view that in order to sustain the contract, they needed to have a financial intervention. I think, as we've described it, their application of fines or service credits wasn't having the desired effect. And without alternatives being explored, I think we're into the realms of actually just the sustainability of this contract. As we've seen in other circumstances, private sector providers can resign from a contract. And I would be taking an additional leap and speculating that whether that would be an alternative, but it's undoubtedly a risk that the Prison Service would have considered.
Thank you.
Thanks. I'm going to invite Colin Beattie to put some questions to you. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Auditor General, I want to cover initially an area, obviously, about staffing levels and so on. We've touched on that already. If we look at paragraphs 20 to 22, and in particular 20-22, which talks about the 20-25% decrease in staffing below required levels. And the comments there about comparatively low pay, and you've done a comparison to supermarkets. To me, it seems there's only three possible reasons for this. Either there are no staff to be able to recruit, shortage of staff in the market, difficulties with retention. The staff levels have been dropped in order to make the contract financially sustainable for the company as a deliberate policy. And I guess leading off from this possibility that staff levels were cut by the company to make the contract sustainable is linked into that deliberate suppression of salary levels. And I know later on there's talk about increased salary levels being offered in order to be able to recruit staff. Why didn't they do that earlier? So what, in your opinion, is behind that? Was it deliberate? Is it the market? Is it what?
So we've not seen any evidence, Mr. Beattie, this is a deliberate attempt to make the contract unsustainable. That's not our understanding. And again, Michael can provide the committee with a bit more insight in some of the understanding that we have about the engagement that the Prison Service has had with GEO-AME as Michael sets out, on a quarterly basis. Our impression remains that there are attempts ongoing to sustain the delivery of this contract, both from Scottish Prison Service and their partners, and also the interaction that they've had with GEO-AME. So we don't believe that there's a deliberate manipulation of prison custody officer numbers to try to generate more profits. I think there are more fundamental issues that the disruptive nature of the pandemic has caused to the volume of the delivery of this contract, together with changing working patterns, people's aspirations, what they want in terms of pay, terms and conditions, the environment that people work in. And most significantly of all, these are very demanding jobs, and they don't attract high levels of pay. And in that environment, turnover will be higher. So I think the steps that we're seeing the Prison Service taking in more recent times, for the pass-through funding, the additional to go into the pay pockets of prison custody officers. I can see there is logic to why that would be, but for the other circumstance you said, I'm not sure we are seeing that manipulation. But again, I think it would be maybe useful for the committee just to hear more from Michael about the nature of the engagement that the prison service is having with GOME.
I think we see quite sharp fluctuations in staffing levels with GOME. As the report mentions, the staffing complement was at appropriate levels to begin with. The service was provided to agreed levels. What we find is that they can recruit okay. Retention can be difficult. We saw the numbers come back up to about 660, I think it was, full-time equivalents in October 2022, but then they fell quite sharply as a result. So it's not just about recruitment, it's about the retention as well, and levels of attrition are quite high. There's daily engagement with GOME because you have a system where appointments are booked for prison transfers, for hospital appointments, to support court docs and court cells and so on. And when these don't happen, then it's known. So there's daily communication between the prison service and GOME about the reasons why and so on. So staffing levels, convener, you mentioned about the sort of comparisons with the retail sector. I think it's fair to say the prison service is also a competitor in this in terms of the staff that they employ. We've seen some examples where staff have gone from GOME to be employed by prison service. In fairness, we've seen it going in the other direction as well. So there's a number of moving factors with this. But it always comes back to the fundamental that they weren't paying staff enough, I think, to keep them. You know, low pay rates by comparison generally means that people won't stay for the periods they need. And in addition to what the Auditor General has said, probably not very attractive roles, given some of the risks, some of the physical demands of the role as well.
You, Michael, touched there on hospital appointments, and maybe I can just highlight that. Paragraph 28, paragraph 29, it says that 705 hospital appointments were recorded by GOME as failures, and of these, 561 were cancelled by the escort due to resourcing issues, 86 did go ahead late. But we don't seem to know much about the impact on the prisoners or the NHS for these cancellations. And obviously, the NHS have geared up to receiving hundreds of appointments that are suddenly cancelled, presumably at the very last minute. So the impact on their efficiency, and here we can look at Forth Valley, is not insignificant. So are there any plans to assess the overall impact of these delayed and cancelled NHS appointments, both on the health of the prisoners and on the NHS?
I'm not sure we know further than what we've stated in the report, Mr. Beattie, that this is an issue that needs to be tackled for all the reasons that you set out. It's certainly an area that, you know, impacts not just the prisoner, but the efficiency of the contract, the health, as I mentioned, of the prisoner, but also on the effective operation of both organisations. And you're right to mention Forth Valley. I think, as we touched on in discussions last week, it will have a particular impact upon that health board, given the additional weighting of prison facilities that are within that health board. But it may be an area that the committee would need to follow up directly with the NHS providers.
I think it probably is. Just to move on from staffing levels, the contract's obviously going to be re-tendered. What are the SPS and the partners, what steps are they taking to ensure that this contract will take into account of all the external factors that are believed to be impacting on the current contract? In other words, that we don't head down the same path again. I realise hopefully we won't have COVID to create that disruptive factor. But nevertheless, how are they approaching this?
So there's, as we touch on the report, again, I'll bring Michael in to say a bit more about the, I think, both the learning and the application of that learning from the current contract to future arrangements. So there is a contract unit within the Scottish Prison Service that is gearing itself up for the next iteration of the contract. And bear in mind that we are 4 years potentially away from that. And I think I'm also right in saying, I call it 26, my apologies, and colleagues can, but there's also an additional four-year option in terms of the contract. So, well, the option, I think, ultimately be for both parties to decide whether or not they wish to extend the contract. That's all, of course, set against, as we set out in the report, sustainability issues for the contract. So the thinking will need to be worked through fundamentally by the Prison Service and wider justice partners about what's required of the contract, what variation arrangements exist within it too, you know, so whether it's application of service credits or additional funding, and what the triggers would be for either of those factors. There has to be a balance, Mr. Beattie, between the effective performance operation of a contract, value for money for public spending too, and the safety and security of prisoner transport. These are the factors that will need to be weighed up, and that's our expectation and understanding of what the contract unit within the Prison Service and their partners are now doing.
Just to go back on the actual timing of the contract, I believe it actually ends in January 2027. So tendering is expected to start in 24, which seems an awful long way in advance, but maybe that's how long it takes. Presumably you've seen nothing as yet as to what the approach is going to be.
Michael can clarify, Mr. Beattie, but I think what this would be the early preparatory work to ready the Prison Service for tendering arrangements at the right time that it's appropriate for them to go to market. I think it's fair to say that a contract of this complexity and drawing on experiences from when it was tendered last time round, that there was only one bidder isn't a place where any public service provider would ideally want to find themselves. You know, you want to have that choice available so that you can do a balanced assessment in terms of price, quality, service provision. So these are the factors I'm quite sure that the Prison Service will be considering as they ready themselves and gear them up for market testing over the course of the next 2 years.
And as this goes forward, are you going to be in a position to monitor the contract and the bidding process?
Yeah, I'm absolutely delighted to confirm that is our plans, that, you know, given how central this contract is to the effective operation of the Scottish Prison Service, but the justice system more widely, it will remain part of our work.
What support is the Scottish Government giving in terms of this process?
In terms of the contract?
Yes.
Tendering?
Yeah.
Again, Michael can maybe say a bit more about the role that the Scottish Government is playing in supporting the contract unit within the Prison Service. But there is expertise within the Scottish Government. Indeed, I think they've appeared, the procurement department team has appeared before the committee in recent evidence sessions. And these are all available for the Prison Service to draw on, especially recognising that the Prison Service is an executive agency of the Scottish Government. So there is a close working relationship between the two. But again, Michael,
they're available. Are they actually going to avail themselves of this facility?
If Michael doesn't know that, then we certainly can come back to you, Mr. Beattie, on this precise role that the government is playing.
So I think it's just too early to say, because I think the discussions will be starting around now. I think we would expect the Scottish Government to be involved. A key aspect of consideration, whether it's part of any retendering exercise or other options for escorting prisoners, the policies that the Scottish Government make have a big impact on what prisoner numbers will be. So, for example, we've got longer-term prisoners as a result of no automatic release and so on. That impacts on prisoner numbers, that impacts on the support and services that, in this case, GUA may need to provide in terms of hospital appointments, transfers and so on. So I would expect the Scottish Government to be around the table at these discussions. The early discussions really need to look at what is the contract hoping to achieve. I think, to be fair and without getting too ahead of ourselves, I think it will be radically different to what is currently in place because of the problems that have existed with the current contract. How that ends up in terms of the time for any new contract to commence, we'll just have to wait and see, but it's one that we'll keep an eye on.
Okay, just move on to the last couple of questions. In paragraph 37, reference is made to the greater number of older prisoners that are within the system. And at last week's evidence session, comment was made on the NHS Forth Valley about the ageing prison population and more pressure on NHS as a result of that. What actually is the impact of a greater number of older services or older prisoners and the level of support that's required? I mean, there seems to be an implication that we should have a care facility within the prisons or whatever. And you know, there's a number of reasons that have been put forward as to why we're having such an older population. There's sentencing, historic sex abuse cases, all sorts of things. How is this impacting on the NHS and the SPS?
So you're right, we did touch on this briefly in last week's evidence session. Mr. Beattie and the committee may have seen some news coverage over the course of the past few days, drawing comment from Governor Beale from Glenochel Prison, which highlights the emerging challenges that the prison service is facing with an ageing prison population for the reasons that you set out as to why there are now many older people in Scotland's prisons. Prisons that weren't designed to cope with such a much wider range of age profile in prisons. I guess we discussed briefly last week also that the NHS provides healthcare services in a prison setting, but the prison service themselves are responsible for care provision. And many of the older prisoners will require care services. So whether it's personal care and the like, these are now fall on the responsibility of the prison service. And I note Governor Beale's suggestion that actually what the prison estate needs to evolve into is a provision of not just secure prisons, but also perhaps secure care facilities. And as we also set out in the report and drawing from our infrastructure briefing of last year, capital budgets are incredibly challenged. So these will be the prioritisation that the prison service, the government and partners will now need to make about what is the service that the prison service is offering to Scotland's prisoners. What's clear to see today, and again drawing on the insight that Governor Beale provides, is that the current estate is not designed to cope with the changing profile of prisoners.
You say that the prison service is responsible for providing the care. It's not presumably the prison officers who presumably cannot be trained or have been trained in that particular area. Do they bring in resources from outside who are qualified to provide that care?
I'll bring Michael back in, actually. I think it may be interesting for the committee. I think Michael and Tommy, as part of their external audit work, actually went to Glenochel Prison just to kind of learn a bit more about the challenges and circumstances that prison is dealing with. So Michael might want to say a bit more.
So you could see some of that, the challenges directly. You know, some of it is just down to the basic daily routines, washing, feeding, clothing, whereas more fundamental things like the services for palliative care to support dementia, mobility issues, as Auditor General mentioned, in some of these Victorian prisons, there's no accessible cells. So that all provides a different dynamic to the care that is provided to prisoners, in particular in that group of the oldest prisoners that are within the system. And they're growing in number, as a result of longer sentences. You mentioned the historic sex abuse cases. So people entering the prison system later in life, It's a big change in dynamic for what the prison service has to manage and so on. There'll be a certain element, I would imagine, that prison officers are able to carry out and support, but the prison service has to bring in the specialists to deal with the more complicated issues, if I can phrase it like that.
So there is a cost to the prison service in bringing services in. I suppose what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to understand the impact on the prison officers and the prison service as such of providing that care. Is it taking their resources, or are they independent resources that are brought in? And you seem to be saying only for the more extreme cases, and that the prison service deals with the sort of day-to-day stuff.
It's probably a combination of both. So a prison like Glenorchy has healthcare facilities in its estate. So you'll have prisoners going to get medical appointments, dental appointments as part of that. It would be more disruptive where they have to be taken to external healthcare facilities involving a prisoner transfer, as we've already covered and so on. So there'll be a demand on prison staff to support the transfers and so on. But in terms of the direct care, that will be done by professionals that are indeed brought in, or the prisoners taken to get that attention.
You're talking about prisoners who have dementia. I mean, presumably they at some point reach a stage where it's not even clear to them whether they're in prison or not. Is there a process whereby they're transitioned out into an existing care facility outside the prison service?
So that's our understanding, Mr. Beattie, that prisoners' health conditions will be considered as part of their suitability for the environment that they find themselves in at certain points in their sentence. I think beyond that, probably the detail of how that's applied is probably a matter for the probation service, together with Scottish Courts and Tribunal, to take a view that perhaps better place to inform the committee's interest in this.
I'm just trying to understand that there's a sensible look at the realities. Just one final question, which is about the prison estate. I mean, the issues that have been reported in the condition of the prison estate, for example, underspends in the capital budget, savings made from reduced planned maintenance. Do you have any particular concerns about that? Just odd, given other comments about the estate.
Maybe bring Tommy in, actually, to say a bit more about the application of the capital budgets. There will be local factors, Mr. Beattie, about the provision of contractors available to service particular aspects of the estate. I think our conclusion is that the estate's under pressure in terms of both maintenance, but also, as Michael mentioned, the reasons for why its suitability to provide a modern prison service. We, I think, reasonably draw on the conclusions of the Chief Inspector of Prisons that 35% of Scotland's prison population is still housed in Victorian or Victorian age prisons. We still have prisoners who are sharing cells, and also that the suitability and the durability of these environments, and the extent to which they are consistent with human rights, are concerns that the Chief Inspector has drawn attention to. Having said that, there is absolutely the case that there has been considerable investment in the prison estate. We've had four new prison facilities over the past 20 years, but there's a way to go, and still an evolution of requirements, given the changing nature of the prison and the longevity of the state in the round. So there's work to be done in this area, Mr. Beattie, no doubt. But Tommy might want to say a bit more about just the application of the budget. Tommy.
Yeah, thank you, Auditor General. For the 24-25 budget, we noted that there's additional funding being provided to progress development at HMP Glasgow, the replacement for HMP Berlinney, and also HMP Highland, which is taking over from HMP Inverness. There's an additional £70 million. I think the total is now £167 million in capital funding in 24-25 to support that. As the Auditor General highlighted, there has been refurbishment and redevelopment work ongoing over the past 20 years, not just with the new facilities that the Auditor General mentioned, also community facilities to support female prisoners prior to release, and also in terms of refurbishing the prison estate. But I think the fundamental issue is still there, particularly HMP Berlinney, which is an ageing prison. It's relied upon by the Scottish Prison Service for surge capacity, so when there are fluctuations in the prison population, it's Berlinney that's asked to kind of provide the flex there. And given the age and condition of that building, there is an increased risk to the Scottish Prison Service of failures and how they would manage that in such case. So, yeah, there is ongoing redevelopment work, but it's worth noting that the HMP Glasgow project has been on the major capital project list for a number of years, and it's just a case of getting the funding in place for that, which I believe the Prison Service are hoping to have this year.
Clearly, Berlin is a bit of a priority. Just very simplistically, we're talking about an underspend on the capital budget. That was in 2018-19. Presumably the underspends are not real underspends. They're just money that hasn't yet been paid out for ongoing contracts and so on. Is it as simple as that?
I think that's a pretty fair assessment, actually, that underspends will be consumed as they move forward in tackling the challenges that the estate is presenting. There is not yet enough capital available to tackle all of the requirements that the Scottish Prison Service needs to in terms of its estate. So there are time, effectively what you're describing are timing differences. Tommy's fair to mention that capital investment is being applied, particularly for new prison facility in the Highlands, but also a significant decision to be made by ministers for the timing, the cost of the replacement for HMP Berlinney in Glasgow. Work is progressing on that, is our understanding. Consideration will also be made by ministers following their assessment of the business case. But these are the key challenges in terms of the...
Is there a timescale for that?
As our understanding, that's due this year, Mr. Beattie. I'm not sure we're able to be any more precise than that, actually. I'm sure the committee did too. Read carefully through the Director General for the Scottish Exchequer's submission to the committee in terms of the major capital projects update. And I think what we can hope to see is that there's a position laid out when the government publishes its next medium-term financial strategy and the accompanying infrastructure investment programme, which I think is due in May of this year. So if not the precise detail at that stage, hopefully over the course of 2024.
Now, previously, just one last question. Previously, reference has been made to reducing plan maintenance in order to achieve savings. Now, that, of course, is really just pushing a problem into the future. Are you satisfied with the programme of maintenance that's in place for the prison estate?
It's probably a level of assurance beyond what I'm able to offer the committee this morning, that there are clearly challenges in the prison estate, you know, in terms of issues that have been highlighted, primarily drawn on the reporting of the Chief Inspector of Prisons that draws attention to unsatisfactory conditions within the prison estate. That's not to say, though, that the money isn't being spent properly from what's available. I think it's both of those things. So it might be well being spent appropriately, but just that the budget isn't enough to tackle all of the requirements within the estate. So our audit work isn't drawing attention to capital spending being made inappropriately, but it isn't yet tackling what effectively needs to be a transformative approach that addresses the fact that 35% of Scotland's prisoners are still residing in Victorian-era accommodation, Mr. Beattie.
Reference to savings being achieved by reducing maintenance are slightly historic in that they're several years ago. Is that still the case now? Because you can have any sort of budget, but if you're going to be creating savings out of that by cutting the maintenance,
I'll bring Tommy in, actually. Tommy's looked a bit more detail on this during the course of the audit, but I think in overall terms, the financial position of the prison service is challenged. They have had additional financial support in terms of the 24-25 revenue budget and additional capital provided, but in terms of some of the detail, pass to Tommy.
Can comment on the fact that
short of time. Okay. You've had about three last questions. I think I'm going to have to ask if we can move on and invite Graham to put some questions. Graham.
Well, thanks very much, convener. Mr. Beattie has mopped up rather a lot there in that session, including some questions around Barlini and the replacement of Barlini. I mean, you've said, Auditor General, that we're expecting a business case sometime this year for HMP Glasgow. Well, all right, so we'll get a business case, but then, you know, the funding has to be approved. And you know, how long do you think it will be before we actually see a new prison?
It's probably unhelpful for me to speculate, Mr. Simpson, on when that will happen. I think what we've seen and what we set out paragraph 55 is this: the consideration of a replacement for HMP Barlini has been ongoing now for over 10 years from the first iteration of its inclusion in the infrastructure investment plan in 2011, and then again our more recent plan in 2015. So we don't know when that new prison will open, and I think we also don't know what its final cost will be. As plans exist at the moment, I think it's reasonable to say that costs will be more than they were when the last figures were attributed to it, because of known factors we've seen against many other capital projects in terms of build cost inflation, availability of labour, external factors such as conflict in Ukraine have all led to capital projects costing more. The committee, of course, will be familiar that prioritisation is where the government is now at, and the publication of its next infrastructure investment programme will be key in setting out where HMP Glasgow, in terms of the consideration of the business case based on existing designs or otherwise, sits alongside the government's other priorities. So we look forward to seeing its publication.
Okay. I think if we have the prison service in, we could ask them questions about that. Can I go back to some of the stuff you said earlier? I mean, you were mentioning, there was mention of pay rates and the differential of pay rates between prison officers and people who work for GeoAmey. I was just having a quick look there, and the starting salary for a prison officer is $24,700, rising to $28,400 after 3 years. Do you know what GeoAmey staff are being paid?
I'll ask Michael, actually, if we have the detail of that. I think maybe helpful to draw a comparison of what the application of the flow-through funding has been also in terms of 17% increase in early rates.
I don't have that information to hand, but we could look to see if we can find that out to make that comparison.
I think that would be useful because it's come up. We've made the comparison between what GeoAmey staff are paid and supermarket workers, for example, or prison service staff. I think it would be useful to know what the difference is.
I think it's absolutely fair, and I say we can commit to come back to the committee on that point. I think it's also relevant, and Mr. Beattie touched on our last report on the Scottish Prison Service in 2019, some of the challenges in staffing levels. One of the key features of that report was the application of what's referred to as ex gratia payments. So it's, I don't think this is necessarily a direct comparison, Mr. Simpson, that would suggest in terms of the hourly rate for the staff working for GeoAmey, but also those that are working for the prison service. The committee will recall that one of the aspects of ex gratia payments was that just some doubts about its application, the control environment around it and the totality of it. So even allowing for pay rate growth as that we've seen over recent years, Scottish Prison Service paid £6.3 million in ex gratia payments during 22-23, and that jumped by 46% from the previous year. So all I think it echoes probably the judgments that my predecessor made about the challenges that the Prison Service was facing in terms of staffing levels are largely still the same. So it is also the case that, well, whilst there may be movement between prison custody officers into Scottish Prison Service employment, it isn't addressing the overall sustainability of the service. So I'm very happy to do that comparison, Mr. Simpson, but I think, you know, there are a range of factors that are driving the sustainability of staffing levels in the prison service.
Sure, okay. I'll leave that with you. So you said that Geo Amy could resign the contract, is that correct?
I think in any contract, actually, there is the opportunity for the provider to resign it, to resign from it, but with the potential application of penalties and termination arrangements that would be set out in the contract, yes.
So is it, in your view, is there a risk that this contract, given the problems that it's had over several years, could fail?
I don't think it's much of a stretch to say that, yes, there is a risk in any contract that it could fail. And I think especially given the level of challenges and that we are highlighting risks to its sustainability, then that is a factor that the Prison Service is going to have to carefully manage with its partners in conjunction with, through dialogue with the service provider, Geo Amy, yes.
Okay. Did you speak to Geo Amy at any point?
Yes, we did, and we engaged with Geo Amy actually through, and Michael can say more about the engagement that we had, to reassure the committee when we publish any report, if it makes reference to any organisation as part of our processes, we will bring this to their attention through fact-checking and an opportunity to engage with them. So Michael can set that out for the committee.
Yeah, really nothing more to add to that, but we shared the content of the draft report with them and invited any comments on factual accuracy, as we do with all our reports. And the managing director at GOA may have got back in touch with some comments and that we considered and reflected in the final draft.
So what's GOAME's sort of position on all this?
So I think, to be fair to GOAME, I think they accept that the performance has been poor. I think they accept that staff numbers haven't been there. It would be very difficult, I think, for them to dispute otherwise. I think they'll maybe have a slightly different view on the circumstances behind or the impact of the changes to the contract as a result of COVID and so on. These are big factors, but as I said earlier, the main one is that GOAME haven't had the staff to service the contract. So I think it's from GOAME's point of view that they accept the failings, but I think their focus will be more on the changes to the environment as been a main cause of that.
All right. Would you say that the problems really started occurring because of COVID or around about that time, or were there problems before that?
So I think in general terms that is a fair conclusion to reach. The report touches on, I think there were initial teething problems with the contract which were resolved, you know, whether through service credit application or improvement notices. So in general terms, and Michael might wish to elaborate, is that in overall terms the contract was performing as intended before the pandemic. But the disruptive nature, for the reasons that we've set out to a degree this morning, have resulted in the contract not being, not operating as intended and risk to its overall sustainability, Mr. Simpson.
Yeah, I would certainly agree with that. Some of the earlier teething problems were just around the flexibility required with the contract, so supporting hospital appointments at the same time as transfers to co-op, the demands of hospital detainments and bed watches and so on. I think these were the sort of initial teething problems just you would probably get at the start of any contract until it beds down. But certainly the impact of COVID, prisoner numbers dropped during that time because the court cases weren't come through, but now we've seen that increase back up in many cases. And as I said earlier, it's a volume-based contract. So the more activity that GOAMA can undertake, then the more income they can generate from it.
Okay. In terms of an improvement notice, what does an improvement notice involve?
It's effectively a letter that will be sent from the prison service to GOAMA laying out the points of or the areas of the contract where service is underperformed. There's no real trigger for it other than a view by the prison service that an area has underperformed. The purpose or the point of an improvement notice is really to encourage a sort of short and sharp recovery in reaction to it, as you see with the first improvement notice that was issued in relation to hospital appointments. But they weren't really designed to address the quite seismic failures that we've seen in terms of service performance. And so the subsequent ones are actually still live, the improvement notices. They haven't been resolved. I think one of the issues in subsequent notices were that, so to address one area, for example, hospital appointments, you would see staff, GOAMA staff, being transferred to support that part of the contract, and you would see the service dropping in other parts. So some of the subsequent improvement notices address that point, that improvements are required in certain areas, but it shouldn't be the detriment of the improvement notices that are currently in existence. But then you get to the point where the improvement notices were not having any real effect, the problems being a lack of staff.
Okay. So which areas are still outstanding then?
So the first one around hospital appointments has been resolved. The second the subsequent ones are all still live. If I just get the paragraph reference at 29, so issues around data accuracy and verification. There was a further one around hospital appointments in December 2022. Police identification parades in February 2023. And the most recent one, June 2023, in relation to supporting court sale and court docs delivery. These ones are, as I understand it, are still live.
That's quite a list then. So what happens if these things are not resolved?
So it's all part of the same discussion. There's nothing specifically tied to the improvement notice. Improvement notice, as I said, are designed to address either action to improve it within 14 days or with an action plan over a longer period of time. But as I said, we've not seen the quick recovery as a result of the improvement notice. The problems are more fundamental than that.
Just to add, Mr. Simpson, I think the prison service has changed tact in terms of its approach to arriving at a sustainable contract. So as Michael says, that they could continue to issue improvement notices and service credits, but it's clear that they've reached a view that that approach won't lead to a sustainable contract and better service provision. So they're now in the position of applying, as we've talked about, flow-through funding. We're going to have to wait another 6 months or so to see if that is successful. But there are fundamental risks to the sustainability of this contract. So I think that is a reasonable approach that the prison service is taking, that using service credits, improvement notices and additional funding. They'll have to reach a point over time, though, about how sustainable that is. Is it delivering value for money in terms of public expenditure and service performance? And whether they do that for the duration of this contract or there's an intervention, that's the choice that the prison service and their partners will have to make. If they didn't do the alternative in terms of financial support, ultimately, I think what we've seen in other public contracts, there comes a point of intervention. Let's say that the contract is not being provided to the terms and conditions and contract termination arrangements, but that's not without risk. and the question facing the prison service, well, who's going to step in? And is that going to come with additional public expenditure and potentially better performance? These will be the judgments for the prison service.
Okay. Last question from me. Have we got any idea how many court cases have been impacted by the, you know, the issues with this contract?
Michael may have that. With what we've set out, I think we can certainly refer to prisoner transfer issues affecting court appearances, also police identification parades, as well as hospital appointments. We've got a specific example again at paragraph 29, Mr. Simpson, about the implication of it is being felt across the justice system. An example of a solemn case being interrupted due to the prisoner not arriving on time. Beyond that, if we don't have the precise details, certainly we can check our records and inquire further with the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, but Michael may know further at the moment.
The focus of what we have, particularly around Exhibit 1, looks at the percentage of court arrivals and the performance against that. So if we look at the quarter 3 2023 performance, then there's been total movements of just about 18,700 for court arrivals. The performance against that was, you know, 61.6%, which is a good 26-27% below the target. That's prisoners not arriving in time. I don't think we've got the data, but I would imagine the prison service will have, of did that result in delays to proceedings. If it did result in delays to proceedings, there would have been a service credit penalty applied. But in some cases, if it's still a delay, but it hasn't delayed proceedings, then a points application is applied before it reaches a threshold.
Thank you, Auditor General. I don't believe that we've got any numbers in terms of actual figures, but what our kind of work did identify was that as part of the kind of Scottish Courts Recovery Programme, there has been kind of changes to that due to issues with the GOAMI contract. So, for example, with the rollout of virtual custody hearings, more localised virtual custody hearings, that had to be delayed because GOAMI were unable to service that part of the contract and to support them with that. So, as I say, we don't have any specific numbers, but we do know that it's having an impact on...
Be able to get the numbers?
We can certainly ask, yes.
I think that would be quite useful. OK, thanks, Convener.
OK, thank you very much indeed. Just before we leave the subject of improvement notices, in paragraph 29 of the report, you also refer to an improvement notice that was served in May 2022, in which you say the notice also highlighted significant issues in relation to the accuracy of verified data to assure the Scottish Prison Service that billing information is correct. I mean, I have to say that rang a bit of an alarm bell for me and reminded me of instances, admittedly, south of the border, where I think Serco and G4S had responsibility for community payback schemes and were charging the government for prisoners that they claimed they were tagging who were either dead or were back in prison. Is there anything of that sort of order going on here?
So I don't think we're drawing that direct analogy, Convener, in terms of concerns about the regularity of expenditure, which I think is effectively what you're describing in Scotland. But it is an important concern that the prison service haven't been assured about the provision of the contract. The improvement notice is an important statement therein, but in terms of the scale of the issues in Scotland compared to what was reported in England, we're not seeing that detail. Michael might want to add a bit more.
Yeah, I think just that. I think it's a very important part of the contract because it obviously drives out what the invoicing will be and what the payments will be. And I think it was about, as I said earlier, the verification performance indicator, information in relation to verification of data is one of the performance measures that's not subject to moratorium because of its importance that needs to be accurate. So there still is concerns there. As I said, these are looked at on a daily basis because of the number of prisoner movements, the support to court services and so on. If things don't happen, it gets noticed. And there's a monthly billing arrangement in place and a reconciliation that takes place with that. So it's something that's still an issue, but I don't think it's as fundamental as the issues you highlight.
Okay, thanks. We are quite pressed for time. I'm going to move straight to Willie Coffey. Willie.
Thanks, Convener. I just want to stick for a wee minute on my question on getting the prisoners to something on time, whether that be the court, the hospital, or ID parades, or whatever. Just to try and find out what the real reason behind it. I mean, if a prisoner's due to be at something where there's a time clash, it's impossible to get them there, and more staff and more money is not going to change that. Has something happened to the timing and scheduling and all these things that are impacting? Is it post-COVID increase in activity or catching up in the backlog? Is that a factor in this sort of general?
So you're right, Mr. Coffey. There is a range of factors, but some of them intuitively feel more straightforward to resolve than others. So as we touched on already this morning, that NHS appointments are coinciding with when prisoners, and primarily the staff, would be expected to support court attendance, feels like something that should be able to be resolved. Other elements of it about increased volume are more challenging factors that, in respect of court's backlog, will be playing into it. But you would expect the prison service and their partners in the NHS on the hospital appointment bit should be able to find a resolution. I say that from a perspective of not knowing the detail and understanding that there will be complexities and challenges within parts of the public sector. But just looking at the exhibit that Michael referred to a moment or two ago, the volume is stepping up. So we're now at court arrivals. Leaving aside performance for 1 second, you can see the change that the pandemic has had in terms of 2021, 13,000 court arrivals, and that jumps to nearly 19,000 in 2023. So volume is a factor, availability of staff, but some of these things are more challenging than others to resolve.
I see in the report as well, I think there may have been a request to the NHS to help with this scheduling. Has that been rejected? Turned out, do we know the reasons why? Is it still ongoing to try and resolve that particular problem?
Our understanding is unresolved. So the detail, the factors behind that, I think, will be probably best explained by the Scottish Prison Service and the NHS.
OK. In terms of, other members were talking about the potential of the contract failing overall, and this might be a factor in that, the 62%, 65%, 61% performance rates for key activities within the contract. Is that, if that happens, what's the SPS and the government and everyone else doing by way of contingency to make sure that we can continue the service that we need?
Yeah, this is fundamental. Michael can say a bit more about the scenario planning that's underway that is key, because whilst the prison service themselves can apply improvement notices, service credits, flow through funding, there is no guarantee that these will be successful. They do have a contract with joint venture and GOAME, but these will be driven by shareholder expectations, management executive decisions by that company. And there is precedent, Mr. Coffey, as you'll know, where private sector provider can resign from a public sector contract. The obligation then still exists with the Scottish Prison Service and their partners to make this work. And as I mentioned earlier on in the session, that the roles that are provided by prison custody officers can only be replicated by prison officers or the police. So this is the type of scenario planning that they'll need to be thinking about to ensure the safe operation of this service in the event of termination by either party. But I'll pass to Michael to say a bit more of the detail.
I think certainly the performance stats that we've highlighted have been a driver for the prison service and its partners to look at the contingency arrangements that may imply. So whether that's to step into the contract to other providers, whether that's to default or termination. They've concluded at the moment that they want it's in the best interest for the contract to continue, but for the service to improve. The Auditor General highlights a couple of points. For example, you could have police officers stepping in to provide support for police ID parades. You could have prison officers supporting prison transfers. You don't have any equivalent in the courts to support court docks or court cells. Only prison officers and police officers are trained in control and restraint measures. So that's something that GUMA provides. So you would have an absence there that needs to be filled. Do you fill it with prison officers? Do you fill it with police officers? Do you try and get another third-party provider? These are all expensive, not in terms of the additional immediate money that would be required, but also what does that mean for the business-as-usual services provided by Police Scotland and the prison service? Even at the moment, we found out that the prison service are providing up to 20 full-time equivalents per day to substitute for some of these service failures and making some of these transfers, particularly on the higher priority transfers to hospital appointments and so on, that need to happen at a certain time.
Okay, thanks for that. Could I move on to prison general? Just on the general prison population numbers issue, Auditor General, that again members have mentioned several times, and you've explained the numbers are going up. To what extent are those increasing numbers due to, the unpacking the backlog, court appearances and so on, longer sentences being imposed for certain offences, improving clear-up rates and so on? So are we seeing the unravelling of the COVID impact on these numbers, and would you expect it at some point to begin levelling off or reducing?
So all those factors are relevant, Mr. Coffey, in terms of particularly tackling the backlog. As we've explored to a degree this morning already, the approach to historic sexual offences as well is also impacting on prison population, but also the age profile and the complexity of prison population numbers in the round. I'll bring Tommy in a moment, actually, you can say a bit more about the factors behind this, but also the management that the Scottish Prison Service are applying to what is fairly sophisticated forecasting that is in place within the service to have an idea of the demands upon them. There's complexities, no doubt, in this, because it's not a straight equation between we've got X number of prison places and projected requirements for them. Given the complexity of managing the estate, particular prisoner types, by way of not just the age profile, but also the need for different types of accommodation, segregation for those convicted of serious major crime, organised crime, all have to be housed in different environments. Tommy's mentioned already a point about surge capacity. So typically that's used in HMP Barlinnie to support, where capacity is required beyond the kind of operational norms. But there are implications for that too, so in terms of rehabilitation, work programmes, educational arrangements and so forth. But again, Tommy can set that out in a bit more detail.
Yeah, thank you, Auditor General. Yeah, Mr. Coffey, all of the reasons that the Auditor General has mentioned are relevant. The longer sentences, serious or increased links to serious organised crime groups, the rise in historic sexual offences. I'd also highlight the Prisoner Control of Release Scotland Act, which I believe was introduced in 2015, and that ended the automatic early release of long-term prisoners. Previously, that would kick in after two-thirds of their sentence, and that's in essence meant that those in custody are staying there for longer. In terms of the challenges that the Auditor General set out as well, within the report we do highlight the operating capacity that the prison estate is working to, and that's something that they continue to try and establish a true capacity with, because the capacity isn't as such a specific number. It's more likely to be a range of number, and it will depend on various factors, including the type of prisoner that's being accommodated. The Auditor General mentioned the use of double occupancy in cells. Before those in custody can be put in that accommodation, there is a detailed risk assessment undertaken, both taking into account the type of crime, looking at who they could be accommodated with, and it goes without saying, if you've got a higher proportion of prisoners that can be occupied in those cells, the true capacity will be higher, and if there's a higher risk profile, it will be lower. So yeah, there's a lot of complicated factors that feed into that.
I presume the SPS is reviewing all of this, Auditor General, especially the capacity issue, if the numbers go up in the way that you describe.
Yes, they are, Mr. Coffey. I think, you know, that's a key part of their management of prisoners and their estates. I think one of the points perhaps worth highlighting is that it's getting harder to do this with the estate that the prison service has. So that's one of the key conclusions from the Chief Inspector of Prisons, that as prison population is increasing, the levers available to the prison service are reducing. So while surge capacity is an option available, it does reduce their rehabilitation aimed activities, so, you know, whether it's vocational or educational activity, which, although increasing, is still below COVID levels. As part of our audit, we look at the operational performance of the prison service. So Tommy, Michael and colleagues draw attention through their audit to the fact that, you know, whilst the environment is challenging, there are some positive signs of performance. So that assaults by prisoners on other prisoners is reducing, as are assaults on members of staff. And these were factors that we had referred to in the previous Section 22 report. The overall status, though, Mr. Coffey, is that the service is under pressure, and as prison population is growing, there are challenges in terms of managing the estate and the sustainability of the service.
And then on the flip side of this, Auditor General, where you haven't quite touched on it in your report, the efforts by the government to try to reduce prisoner numbers using effective measures, you know, with changes in bail and remand that we know about, sentencing and so on, e-monitoring and that. Have you had a chance to assess the impact of that yet, and whether that, or are we still in this unravelling the backlog issue, and we're still at that peak at the moment, but will those measures that the government has been introducing for a wee while now begin to have that impact that we may hope for, to see the numbers being more manageable?
So there's certainly a timing factor here, Mr. Coffey, actually, in terms of the dominant factor is addressing the court's backlog. So as we saw that there was a significant reduction in the prison population during COVID, a presumption against short sentences and so forth. In terms of our own work, it remains a key area of interest. The committee will recall I produced a briefing paper on community justice arrangements in Scotland in the summer of 2021, and it remains a component of our work programme to return to that area in future. And we'll do that bearing in mind, you know, the challenges also that the prison service is facing that we set out in today's report, and really how the totality of the justice system is operating effectively. So, yeah, I'm pleased to confirm that that remains part of our interest. Okay.
Thanks very much, Tommy.
I was just going to come in with a point in that. Well, obviously, the kind of numbers we're still looking at and flowing through, if you look at the longer-term trends, and Scottish Prison Service now publish weekly figures detailing the kind of number of people in prison, over the past 10 years, the number of female women prisoners has reduced by around 100. The number of young people in custody has quite significantly reduced over that time, but the number of adult males continues to increase. So in terms of the kind of reducing numbers, we are seeing that through the kind of number of women prisoners and the number of young people that are in custody, but not yet in the adult males.
Okay. Thanks very much for that. Thank you. Convener.
Thank you. I've just got a couple of questions to finish up this morning. And just touching on that last subject, you're right, Auditor General, as always. You gave evidence to the committee back in September 2021 about the briefing that you had prepared on where we had got to with the government's stated policy of shifting to more community justice options. And I think the evidence for that that was set before us at that time was that, A, it's hugely less expensive for the state, but also that the reconviction rate was noticeably different too. And so I think for those people who'd served a sentence of a year or less in prison, they were, I think 49% of them were likely to reconvict within a year, whereas I think the comparison for those serving community-based sentences was a reconviction rate of 30%. So there was quite a marked contrast in the outcomes there. And I think at that time you told us that there was a lack of progress, was the expression, a lack of progress around shifting the balance in sentencing. So 2 years or more on, where do you see things with that? Because that's obviously got a direct effect on prison population.
Yeah, no doubt, Convener, that's the case, actually. And you're quite right. The custodial sentencing is far more expensive and in some circumstances leads to poorer outcomes. I think we also talked in that session about the, to an extent, I think that would be well understood and expected, the huge disruptive effect that a custodial sentence can have in terms of family relationships, employment opportunities, health prospects into the future. I don't think that we're in a position yet to draw a conclusion yet about the application of the government's plans around community justice because of the numbers skewed by court's backlog and the intent to move to a more stable position in future. I think, as I mentioned to Mr. Coffey, it's very clearly part of our area of interest. I think in terms of both in the sustainability of the service, the future prospects and value for money. So it's our intention to come back to this. If we do have more detail, Convener, actually we can come back to you in writing in the short term, but it remains part of our work programme for the future.
Great. I think that would be helpful because I think that is a component part of this discussion. The other thing which is not new, and you've already alluded to it, is that you produced a Section 22 report on the Scottish Prison Service back in September 2019. And the predecessor committee to this was so, I think it's fair to say, concerned about what that report was saying that it undertook its own inquiry and brought in its own witnesses to try to get to the bottom of things. And one of the things that came out of that, and one of the key findings and conclusions from that report, which came out now 4 years ago, and I have to say, when I'm reading that, it looks like a lot of those issues are the same issues that we're discussing today, that they remain by and large unresolved. But one of them, which is contained in the report, is this. According to the Auditor General, HMP Barlini presents, and I quote, the biggest risk of failure in the prison system, but warns that there is no clear contingency plan for accommodating the 1,460 prisoners it then held. Has there been a contingency plan for HMP Barlini?
Tommy might be able to say a bit more about the specifics of the plan, Convener, but before addressing that point, a couple of things I maybe add is that the issues that my predecessor set out in her Section 22 report in 2019 are largely the same as the overall issues that the prison service is facing today. My Section 22 report focuses on the two specific issues largely of the prison numbers. So three issues, the prison numbers, the estate and the sustainability of the contract. But the work that Tommy and Michael have carried out as part of their annual audit, which underpins the Section 22, there is a high degree of consistency with the findings that the previous auditors made as part of their work. So whether it's with staffing numbers, the estate, the application of ex gratia payments, overall performance, which is at the margin, together with the vulnerabilities I think you're referring to in the Victorian estate that the Chief Inspector of Prisons has more recently referred to, that of the suitability. These are all of the issues that the Prison Service and I think and their partners need to resolve. I think it's important to stress that, Convener, that the Prison Service themselves cannot resolve the scale of the challenges that the service is facing. But in terms of the specifics of the contingency planning for HMP Barlini, short of the longer-term contingency, which is ultimately to build a new prison in Glasgow, I'll see if Tommy has more detail. If not, we may need to engage with the prison service themselves on that point of detail.
Thank you, Auditor General. The Auditor General has kind of set out the kind of size and importance of HMP Berlinney to the prison estate is such that my understanding is that it's very difficult to have detailed contingencies in place. It would require the movement of prisoners to other facilities that at present aren't available. That's not to say that the Scottish Prison Service aren't doing anything to manage those risks. It is on the risk register. There is action being undertaken constantly to kind of manage that risk, but in the absence of any new facilities, it is going to be a challenge for them. And I think it goes back to Mr. Beattie's question earlier. The Scottish Prison Service have had the replacement for HMP Berlinney on their capital plan for a number of years, but it obviously needs approval from the Scottish Government. My understanding is that the Scottish Government currently has the business case and is looking at that at present. I think the potential stumbling block is that they still need to bottom out the price and the costs of it before they're able to provide approval for the project, but they are hoping to achieve that later this year.
Okay, I think Michael Oliphant.
Just to what Tommy was saying there, so the risk of failure of HMP Berlinney needs to be seen in the context of also the work that the prison service are doing around trying to reduce the population. Options are looking at. So the prison service are doing quite a lot of work around repurposing the estate. Tommy mentioned the different trends between the rise in adult prisoners compared to the decline in female and young offenders. So you can repurpose the estate. So you need less facilities for females and young people. Part of the women's regional facility at HMP Edinburgh was repurposed to house male prisoners, with the females housed elsewhere. There's the option of extending the use of electronic monitoring, reviewing the operation of the court recovery programme about the pace of recovery and so on. These are options that are there, but the fail of HMP Berlinney, you're looking at more emergency options, so use of alternative accommodation, temporary or emergency release, use of police cells and things like that. So these are at the more extreme case, but not just around HMP Berlinney, just the options are considering as part of the escalation in prisoner numbers within an ageing and a challenging estate.
But I mean, one of the particular risks, I think, attached to Berlinney is the impact, because of the conditions on the prisoners' mental and physical health, which in turn could potentially, I suppose, lead to litigation linked to human rights and equalities issues. I just wonder whether you've made any assessment of that. I mean, is there a possibility, a risk of a judicial review or some kind of litigation being taken out against the Scottish Government?
So these are facts, again, Michael, I want to say is consideration of the financial assessment that the Prison Service makes, because you know, there is quite a history to this, convener, as you'll recall, of prisoners claiming that you know their rights have been breached and resultant financial implications, you know, going back all the way to slopping out that was required of prisoners and the financial implications of that. I think as it relates to the current environment, you know, this is a live risk. You know, so perhaps not as extreme as we maybe experienced going back to the 1980s, but that the Chief Inspector of Prisoners, as I mentioned a few times already this morning, and I recognise that, is drawing attention to 35% of Scotland's prison population is in Victorian era accommodation. That brings both additional risks, you know, presenting the issue of human rights, but downstream a financial risk to the Scottish Prison Service. In normal environments, what we would expect organisations to do is to consider if that can be quantified, the proximity of the risk in terms of accounting standards as well, whether that needs to be provided for, how it's being managed on a risk register, or indeed whether there's a disclosure requirement. But again, Michael can say a bit more about the precision of whether or not how the Prison Service are treating that.
It is a big risk. Each individual case would need to be looked at on its own to make any assessment and whether there's a likely for a case to be brought and a financial penalty to be applied or a financial impact. But the risks, you know, don't just end with that. One of the key risks that we've looked at is the risk of prison instability and unrest, the reputational risk that comes with it, also the greater strain that applies to prison staff, and we've touched on some of that in other aspects this morning. But it's one of these where they are open to these challenges. The longer that they have these Victorian prisons within their estate, these risks are higher. They won't always go away, but they are higher.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Just building on what Michael said as well, moving away from the kind of financial risks and the litigation risks, our report does talk about the restricted regimes that are in place, and what that means is that for those in custody, there are employment opportunities within the prison, there are training opportunities with college courses provided, but they are limited, and the more you go above the intended operating capacity, that the higher the demand, but the supply doesn't kind of alter with that. So that in itself will also have an impact in terms of prisoners being able to kind of demonstrate core skills to move on to the next stage of their sentence, or to demonstrate that they're ready for release.
Okay, thanks. Can I just, I think you've used the expression a couple of times, Auditor General, about many of these issues that we've discussed this morning are not ones that can be resolved by the SPS alone. I mean, how would you see collaboration working in practice between the SPS and other affected public bodies and the Scottish Government?
It's multifaceted, this convener. So we know that there are good working relationships in place, so that there are multi-agency engagement that takes place between the prison service, the police, courts and tribunal service, and others. Perhaps on a different spectrum, so the NHS issue, feels like one that was discussed this morning that could be resolved perhaps more easily than some of the others. In terms of the application of sentencing, community justice, we've also discussed today too, that and looking really at the estate feels that will be key, unless there's a step change in prisoner numbers or sentencing. And you know, you're right to reference back to community justice paper that Scotland at that point still had the highest prison population in Western Europe. So if that trend continues, the financial risk, the performance risk, will require investment in the estate. So that's going to, you know, need effective engagement with the Scottish Government as well, and consideration of, you know, as ever, capital budgets, revenue budgets and so forth, that there's a long-term plan. It is relevant, convener, that the auditors drew attention in their audit report that the prison service still has work to do in terms of its medium-term financial strategy. That's going to require effective collaboration support with the Scottish Government, because the scale is different from other organisations. So all of these factors, the prison service and the partners, will need to negotiate and navigate over the course of the next few years.
Okay, well, thank you. We've covered a lot of ground. I think there's more that we would have even liked to have got to, but time's been against us in doing that. So can I thank Auditor General you for your evidence this morning, and also Michael Oliphant, Tommy Yule, for the contributions you've made. That's been very valuable in illuminating what is, I think, for us quite a serious Section 22 report into the current state of the Scottish Prison Service. So with that, I'd like to draw the public part of our proceedings this morning to a close and move the committee into private session.